One of our principles to determine if a specific initiative, in this case Ban Man Kong, is transformative is its capacity to enable.
By this, we mean the capacity to remove the barriers to the success of each actor's goal.
The program is a generator of win-win situations between low-income communities and actors from public, private, international and non-governmental sectors to implement housing initiatives involving people as relevant actors in the process of improving their own quality of life.
However, in the field we realize that Ban Man Kong works enabling beyond our expectations. For instance, in Ratanakosin Island, the program represents an opportunity for middle-income people who live in land owned by the Crown Property Bureau to get better tenure conditions.
We also discovered in Phom Mahakam that CODI, as a governmental agency, is an allied of the community against the ongoing process of eviction by another governmental agency, the Bangkok Metropolitan Administration. In this case, Ban Man Kong offers an opportunity of resistance, taking risks and playing with the rules at the limit, providing funds for temporary houses that are not temporary at all.
On the other hand, Ban Man Kong is enabling below our expectations. The poorest of the poor, often squatting or having the worst land tenure conditions, are still out of the program.
There is a pending bridge to be built between the poorest of the poor, their goals, and the other actors involved, mainly related to tenure ownership.
One of our criteria was to measure momentum through the impact of the program as exponential as opposed to linear over time. The various communities we visited in Bangkok were at different stages in the process of upgrading, relocation or negotiation. So initially we thought that the lengthy process was slow and felt slightly impatient to kind of help improve people's lives. But I say improve with inverted commas, as to improve is rather subjective and relative to the circumstance, lifestyle and personal choices of the people. But because of this we later realised that being able to participate in the process is far more important than the actual speed and tangible outcomes of the programme. So for example, take Krungthui. It's the largest and most densely populated district of informal settlements in Bangkok. Our team visited 8 different communities and each had a different approach to upgrading. All of them were at different stages of community capacity, organisation and project completion. So, but the most important issue that arose from talking to people in these communities was the issue of land tenure and ownership. Much like many of the other sites as well, not only Krungthui. Land to an extent affects people's capacity to move forward, obtain legality and feel a sense of belonging to the community and rights to the city. So in effect some communities, due to the lack of finances, community cohesion and motivation, are stuck in limbo. Therefore some people were saying that if other districts aren't too careful, they might be heading towards Krungthui's route, where the transformations are almost stagnant. The question would now be how the momentum of the transformations in each of the other districts are kept at a pace that allowed them room for manoeuvre rather than becoming a stalemate.
I remember what Songsook said about networking and the importance of including people in planning, which was the poor are the scale. The linking of people together provides a platform of scaling up to a realistic scale. I thought that was quite interesting because if you want to solve an issue at a higher level, you must start at the ground level, where the people are at. And it's not about trying to achieve a greater scale, but it starts with knowing that you're talking about scales beyond the community from day one.
She has some really good quotes and that really removes my skepticism about the program, along with actually talking to the community members around our site. It was really interesting to see that the Ban Man Kong program enabled communities to work together and to fight for their rights, but what was even more interesting was that across a few communities in Ratanakosin Island, the Crown Property Bureau adopted the Ban Man Kong program after a couple of failed attempts to provide housing for the poor on their land.
The Ban Man Kong program gave the Bureau means to collaborate with the communities to acquire a longer lease of land. They brought the program to the people in order to negotiate land ownership. It's interesting to see that time can change the way an organization sees things and tries to accomplish it. It's the people of this generation who are becoming more open to helping the poor help themselves. It's not just about securing housing, but the whole idea of networking communities together and getting organizations at the higher level involved in future projects like tourism or community facilities and projects such as youth recycling.
I was talking to a community architect and he was telling us of how universities are becoming more involved and some courses are being changed to teach students more about participatory processes. I guess community architects are like the bridge to local and district authorities. They can negotiate with them and help them understand the community's needs in terms of design preferences for housing and infrastructure or other things. But the question is, how effective is that bridge in different locales? Cody's agenda is about allowing various actors to rethink their situation around them, to find ways of changing things. It's about changing the perceived problem into the solution. The people are the scale. The exchange of knowledge and experiences between different communities is so important for issues to become realized at a greater scale.
Cody's pre-requirement to enter the Ban Man Kong program is for communities to be organized. And as we've seen in Bangkok, a lot of communities are very well organized and they also form a network between them, which makes them stronger. But by the networks, they can also make a difference on local level, not only on the community level. As we've seen in Rangsit, communities are very well organized and they collaborate with local authorities, which makes a difference the way the whole Rangsit is being planned. And local authority has also proposed a redevelopment plan with community redevelopment in mind. If these organizational capacity skills were applied on level like local authority level, then maybe this could make a difference on provincial, national or even international level. As we've seen in Bangkok, there has been a lot of big mega projects and also infrastructure projects. These projects affect local community. If local authorities get organized and form networks between them, maybe they could affect the way mega projects and infrastructure on large scales is planned, and maybe lessen the impact of the way it influences the communities and local areas. Infrastructure and mega projects not only affect local communities in the way they are planned, but they also affect migration from other provinces into Bangkok and from Bangkok to peri-urban areas as well. As we can identify, it is not only important for the communities to get organized, but it is also important for local authorities to form networks and get organized to be able to influence redevelopment of Bangkok as a city and not only as pockets, as it is planned at the moment.
Building and sharing knowledge is an emerging trend among the communities of the Ban Man Kong program. The efficient networks that they've built over the last few years within themselves and other organizations has enabled this process to a large extent. They collect and share knowledge about all sorts of issues, from ways to organize their community and saving money to even job opportunities for the unemployed. They use their existing connections between communities and also try to expand this web through workshops and other learning programs. For example, in Bangpoo, they have so much information about reusable materials and low-cost construction that they make sure every new community that joins the network is aware of this. It's a great practice because it makes the people more conscious of how they use their money efficiently. The sharing of knowledge directly or indirectly also empowers them, and the decision-making process doesn't become top-to-down to some extent. The people are fully aware of what they want and how they want it done. Not only that, they even make suggestions to the architects who work on their project. Hence, the benefits of knowledge sharing is not only for the communities, but also for the people who work for or with them. With Cody giving the head start, various organizations and quite a few architectural universities are taking great interest towards this course, strengthening such learning networks through the BAM Bangkok program.
I remember this lady in the community who told me about how they had connections within their communities during her parents' generation, but during her time and a few years ago, due to urbanization, each community just sticks to themselves and they don't even know who lives in the other community. But now, due to the BAM Bangkok program, the communities are being rebuilt and she actually got in touch with people she knew in her childhood.
This kind of confirms our assumptions during the pre-field trip preparations that the transfer of knowledge at various levels is a consistent process and not a definite outcome. And it should eventually become an iterative process within communities in a locality. And it would be even better if it happens at a larger scale among communities at all locations of the BAM Bangkok program.
There's no doubt that the BAM Bangkok process is iterative. Certainly in the cases I saw, as each community in the program, or soon to be in the program, were consulting each other through regular meetings and discussions. But what became clear was that all are bound by the same rules and regulations. So although the learning is increasing with each project, this is not necessarily reflected in the product. For example, the design and dimensions of the house. When we spoke to the communities regarding incremental building, they were aware it would be a great would benefit a greater range of people and include those who cannot save as much money. But in all the cases we saw, incremental building was not an option, as the local authority require a separate set of applications and permits for each stage of build, and the impression was that the process was lengthy and permission was rarely given, so people ensure they build fully in the first instance. However, the obvious flaw being that as the family grows, the house is unable to grow with it. This means there's no flexibility in terms of expansion of the community also, as once all the households are established, new members cannot join unless an existing member leaves the community, so the structure is broken. Another variable in the process is cost and availability of land. In areas where land is more costly or communities are purchasing the land, the tendency is to focus on maximising the space for housing with little or no open public space. In cases where the community is not purchasing the land, they are able to lease a larger plot and allow for open spaces as well as the commercial space. A way in which the communities have taken what has happened before and made improvements is the Welfare or Social Security Fund. We discovered that in the pilot community, they were not able to support people who struggled financially within the savings groups, and these people were often had no option but to leave the community. However, the newer groups advised that there was a welfare system in place which would ensure people would have support if they encountered financial difficulty. So the programme essentially equips communities with the skills to handle irregular situations within their control without dictating how something should be done. However, other external factors can greatly impede their power to cope with and adapt to irregular situations. BAM Bangkok ensures the community is the lead actor in the process, and as such it is ensured that each project will be slightly different according to the own needs and aspirations of the community. So there is a process of learning from each other and adapting the process accordingly with each cycle. However, there is definitely a need for the process to be more flexible and adaptive.
Due to urban sprawl and rapid redevelopment, it is essential not only to rely on CODI for housing solutions, but also to think about how to redistribute accountability to private sector, as some of the projects executed by them are contributing towards migration and creating more housing problems.
As the private sector and foreign investors will contribute towards land scarcity and density of populated areas. At the moment, this is not addressed by CODI. For instance, in Rangsit, the site could be designed for higher population density, allowing provision for migrants. The migration is already acknowledged by established communities in the area.
Our criteria to measure continuous resistance relates to issues of social justice and obtaining legal rights to own and control land and property. In Bangkok and the two neighboring provinces, we felt many of these communities were resisting eviction through various means and strategies. A common trend, communities were initially mobilized when there was a threat such as a fire or eviction ordered by the landowner. Some communities faced threats of eviction on a cyclical basis, and every time they came back fighting for their rights as Bangkok citizens. Klang Toi's fragmented communities, for example, are at various stages in the development process. Some groups tended to have more motivation or drive to mobilize their neighbors to make a stand and obtain their rights to land, as many of these people have lived in this area for most of their lives, averaging 50 years or more. I remember one community living beneath an expressway who resisted eviction threats by holding community meetings, which at first were unsuccessful, but after a fire hit the largest households, a collective decision was made to strive towards rebuilding and saving up to enter up the Bangkok project. Fighting, it's difficult when they are against the state, but sometimes it's even more draining when challenging a public sector company that seems more powerful than the government itself. This particular community was taken to court and lost, yet they still drove to override the court's orders to negotiate land tenure. And the irony in all this was that the community leaders, the landowner, and their lawyers enjoyed meals during and after court proceedings. And well, is this a testament of the nature of Thai people?
On succession planning, I think we're being overly rigid. First of all, we use the word planning, and Song Suk says not to start from planning, but to empower people to face eventualities and to empower organizations to face eventualities. For us, succession planning was about the autonomy of communities. Take the CDF on our site, for example. We were trying to measure whether it would ultimately give communities financial autonomy. Is this transformative? Maybe if you're trying to transform a little bubble, but if you're looking for systemic change, autonomy is probably counterproductive. Our community at Bangkok was trying to use their CDF to change Cody itself. I think that's successive. I think that's transformative. And that's process-oriented. When the community develops tools to feed back into the system. So maybe succession is dialogue, the transformation of relationships over time. We had a criteria too about the program having support despite political party in power. I think it's important, but I mean, political affiliation is a bit arbitrary in this case, no? I mean, not arbitrary in the sense that obviously the party in power has a strong impact on the poor in Bangkok, but arbitrary in the sense that the mechanism which ensures succession is not affiliation to the elected party, but collective political voice. So again, depoliticizing the program could be counterproductive to transformation.
As a group, we created a set of tools to record our findings and observations in the field, which we thought would aid our work later when we returned to London. However, using our tools on-site was more difficult given the new teams and site agendas. Each site completed one form, but on the whole, the site groups combined the strategies and criteria of each team to formulate an organic and site-appropriate methodology. Initially, it was difficult to listen and actually hear each other's ideas and opinions, and so meetings were lengthy and draining, with many of us feeling unheard. However, the open nature of the group to air views allowed for better conversations and swift resolution of misunderstandings. The challenge was often to allow for those unheard voices to become part of group discussions and verbalize interest, often clarifying thoughts and ideas. One method was using the yes and approach as opposed to the no but. During the course of the fieldwork, it became apparent through working independently and collectively that as a team, we were on the same wavelength. Our thinking became more coordinated as we were making similar decisions in our subgroups, then coming together to realize that we were all either thinking or doing the same thing. Although professionally we may not have the same ideologies, we have come to learn from each other through listening and understanding each other's perspectives. On a personal level, we have become more tightly knit as we went through the process of dividing into subgroups, site groups, and returning as a collective.
Out of a number of questions that emerged from the analysis of each of our sites, one thing evolved around the fact that the development of Bangkok is characterized by pockets. While, for example, on a community scale, the nature of these pockets enhance community cohesion, consensus finding, and safety, the single access site, house topology, minimal open space, and exception from general building codes could also mean that this place remains an exception in the city, despite the upgrading, which can lead to vulnerability in the long term. The following five strategies have the goal to open the pockets of the city and intend to reach a scale on a social, spatial, and institutional level. The connectivity and integration of the pockets of the city is crucial in both social and spatial aspects. As Samsung told us, people are the scale and also the solution. And housing in the Bangkok-Thailand program is the process to build community. Despite the importance of the process of design, the outcome shouldn't be neglected in order to create innovative solutions regarding quantity and quality. Density could be understood as a spatial scale alongside the social or people scale. This spatial scale can be investigated deeper, considering site-specific urban design instead of predetermined building typology, or codes and regulations could take in consideration the pressures on each area. Pilot projects are a starting point to encourage new district or city-wide standards. The balance of process and product can be transformative. Space and buildings as a product of design can function as a catalyst to increase momentum.
Moving away from community architect as a translating facilitator, this strategy builds on existing community mobilization and networks in collaboration with multidisciplinary practitioners in order to enable physical and territorial scaling up. Involvement of practitioners from different backgrounds will result in more holistic and context-appropriate design. Two-way dialogue exchange between these parties will improve the output product, which in turn would be used as a catalyst to assist in going to scale. Unlike other local authorities, Rangsi Local Authority has been successfully collaborating with communities and CODI to produce an inclusive and sustainable development plan. It is also actively supporting communities in the search for land and provides services to relocation land. This collaboration can be used as a precedent for other local authorities. In addition, knowledge and experience sharing on municipal level could help build resistance and through collaboration with private investors, lessen the impact of mega and infrastructure projects on the local redevelopment plan. The participation of communities should not only be limited to decisions on specific communities, but should also expand onto other participatory processes such as participatory development planning and participatory budgeting. City-scale projects and common issues can be used to connect groups and sectors to form partnership in achieving inclusive, integrated city. The infrastructure projects can be used as a tool to bring together different parts of the city and connect actors with different agendas around common interests. This could be achieved through shared facilities in construction process, such as recycled material banks and bulk buying. Sharing not only materials but also design methods could connect groups and sectors of the common interest and could result in more cohesive streetscape. Furthermore, the projects such as redevelopment of canal could connect different actors in the city. The communities could clean the canal and incorporate the development of canal into their community redevelopment plan. municipalities could act as enablers and facilitators to support the communities.
The final strategy addresses the integration of local knowledge about the community's building and development processes and the implementation of the Ban Mekong program. Strategies that develop locally to overcome barriers in the program are strengthened to ensure the program adapts to challenges and integrates new ideas as part of the process of transformation. More concretely, this could be the scaling up of the role of CDF funds. These are currently used in some communities as bridge funds to overcome delays until loans are received from CODI. Through the fund, project implementation can start on the basis of MOUs instead of finalized land negotiations. These, in quotation marks, temporary buildings, are also a manifestation of the group's knowledge and abilities and a strategic way to secure land that can be scaled up across districts.
Ban Mekong is a potential tool to ensure that the actual boundaries of the pockets within the city are blurred to build an inclusive city.